Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I can definitely hear the air of excited expectancy. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome you here. My name's Richard Murphy. I'm the director of the Center for Environment and Sustainability at present. And welcome to the 2022 Roland Clift Lecture. This lecture celebrates 30 years of CES's founding by Roland Clift in the week of Roland's 80th birthday as well. So a double celebration. So we're going to have Roland speak and give his lecture, and we're going to have a panel discussion as well. But first, it's my honor to invite our President and Vice Chancellor, Max Liu, to formally open this event. Max.
Thank you very much, Richard, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And it's great to see so many of you here. A warm welcome on behalf of the university. I also see so many familiar faces, friends from the different world, different era, so many chemical engineers here. They are, I just said to Richard Darton, I'm sorry, this is the good sort of a reunion of the chemical engineer mafia. So I think I was told there are a lot of people still on the road, maybe stuck by the Extinction Rebellion people, but they're all welcome here. I think it's great to have this occasion to celebrate the remarkable journey of the CES, and in honor of the founder, and of course the guru in this area as the pioneer in industrial ecology and life cycle analysis. Now what we now trying to do is to really build on this as a university, as a leading institution in sustainability in general. 30 years ago, of course, we know what happened. Roland came and had the foresight, the vision to set up this multidisciplinary center that ever since flourished. And actually, I also welcome many of the alumni and also current students and colleagues and friends to this occasion. Its success is very evident. Of course, it's built on the visionary Roland Clift research and the network he built, and the collaboration partnership with industry and many industry sponsors and collaborators here tonight. So I'm so proud to say that we want to do more. As a university, last year we established the people-centered AI Institute across all three faculties, but we also established and we're just in the process of officially launching the Institute for Sustainability that brings together expertise from across the university to address the grand challenges, and be it in the social sciences and health sciences and engineering. Our new institute is is kind of a synthesis center. I think later on you will hear from the mouth of the host, that is the founding director, Lorenzo, who is going to talk a bit about his vision. And we're very lucky to attract Lorenzo from South Africa. He's a former minister for education in Italy, and he's a world-leading scholar in political economy in sustainability. Right, I'll leave that to later. The panel session, I think we will hear from the preliminary founding director, of course, Roland himself, a journey in sustainability looking backwards and forwards or ahead will be given by Roland himself. And then, of course, we'll have the panel members. And I think I look at the profile of our panel members. I'm really inspired to see, you know, what our guest speakers have achieved. And in fact, I met Jim just now. Jim is an old friend from Australia a long time ago. But many of the panel members will share their perspective, their insight in this very important area. Right, back to Roland. So Roland, in his own words, getting increasingly unhappy with addressing environmental problems just by trying to develop new things, new technology and gadgets and so on. So that's how he ventured into the industrial ecology, and he pioneered this whole approach, new approach, in addressing the challenges by really incorporating the social sciences, the economists, the sociologists, and many other people from all disciplines in this university to address important challenges. Right, okay, without a further ado, of course, let's hear Roland Clift. Ladies and gentlemen, please give you a round of applause to Roland.
Thank you very much, Max. And I have to say, this is, I think, my 10th farewell lecture. and this one really is a farewell lecture. And before I embark on it, I would like to thank a particular person. In academic circles, we're not very good at thanking our non-academic colleagues. And there was someone who was absolutely critical and central in setting up the centre in the first place. And her name is Sheila Sutherland. And I can't see her, but I know she's here somewhere. Okay. Thank you very much, Sheila. It wouldn't have happened without you. Okay, so into the main theme of the lecture. CES was set up 30 years ago. And sometime later, the university set up the series of Roland Clift Lectures, which you're about to hear. And I wrote a brief on what the lectures should be about. And I'll start with that. Industrial ecology comes into it, of course. And I wrote other things saying that the theme for these lectures had to be based on empirical thinking, based on empirical evidence. And that will come out, I hope, in the course of the lecture. There were very definite reasons for that. I didn't want these lectures to be devoted to abstract subjects like, let me be honest, social theory and neoclassical economics. And I'll enlarge on that one a bit. So there's a particular theme here. 1992 was when CES was set up, but I'll go back slightly further than that to 1990. As Max has already mentioned, there was a national program in clean technology set up by three of the national research councils. And it was set up in response to Margaret Thatcher's famous lecture at the Royal Society 2 years previously. And if you look back at the recordings of that, it's very interesting, because she mentioned climate change as a risk. She mentioned hole in the ozone layer as a risk. She mentioned acid rain as a real problem. And she also mentioned sustainable development. So when she made this really hard-hitting speech, actually, it's nice to find good things to say about Thatcher, and this is one of them. When she made this hard-hitting speech, the Research Council said, we need to respond to this. And what they decided to do was set up a research program in clean technology. Good phrase. Nobody knew what it meant. So they looked around for somebody to spearhead, chair this initiative, and I actually put myself in the way to get the job. because I was interested. So amongst other things, it's enabled me to define what clean technology actually means. And I won't go into that one now, but it's a bit of a, because it's really a subject of a different talk. But as Max has already alluded to, I realized pretty quickly that the reason why we had environmental problems was not lack of technology, it was lack of wisdom in using what we already had. And I realized that that was something which is outside the normal scope of engineering thinking. And that was what led me to set up CES. So there you are, 1992. In a sense, CES is the result of Thatcher's speech. More directly, it's a result of the fact that I got dissatisfied with the purely technological approach. So what was it actually about? Well, at the time, when we were touting around for money to get the thing started, I wrote this description of what CES was about. I referred to sustainable systems, that word sustainability, which I will have to come back to in some detail, was coming into the agenda. Engineering-based approaches with, I think, a slightly patronising reference to the social sciences there, quite honestly. But that was what I said at the time. But maybe this is the more important bit. Action-oriented, policy-relevant responses. So right from the outset, the idea was not that CES would be a purely academic enterprise, producing stuff for publication in the academic journals. We did that, but we also had the aspiration right from the start that we were going to make a difference to the way things were done. And the other, another key thing was my realization from the experience of directing the Clean Technology Program, national program, you couldn't find the answers to environmental problems within a single discipline. So that was really the inspiration to CES, bring some different disciplines together. Now, that has its problems. People who talk about the difficulties of, for example, social scientists working with engineers tend to talk about the difference of terminology, but the terminology is not actually the problem. The problem is the epistemology. It's the way what constitutes knowledge is structured. And in particular, engineering is a decidedly positivist discipline. This is how it is, here's the problem, this is what I'm going to do to solve it. Whereas the social sciences are much more critical. You know, I'm not too sure about that. This is my analysis of the problem, it may be different from yours. And getting those two kinds of approaches to different epistemologies to work together was one of the big challenges in CES. And I think we made some progress in conquering that challenge, thanks in large part to Kate Birmingham, actually, who's in the front row here, who had a joint appointment at the time between CES and the sociology department. And the thing I realized, working mainly with Kate, was that although engineering and the social sciences were usually regarded as being completely separate, and in fact inimical, hostile in some senses, that really was not necessary. And provided you worked with a social scientist who based their work on empirical data, not necessarily quantitative, but empirical results, provided you recognized the primacy of empirical information, it was perfectly possible to work together. And some of the projects Kate and I did together, I have to say I enjoyed very much, whether or not they were particularly productive. And I think that's an important point to leave with anybody who is trying to put together transdisciplinary teams or projects or enterprises. Provided you recognize the importance of empirical data, you've got a very strong basis for working together. At the time, I also articulated three ground rules. Why did I say that? No postmodernists. Well, that went with the commitment to action-directed research. You had to be committed to something. You know, there is a reality out there, and it's... I also very rapidly acquired an aversion to neoclassical economics because it fell through the net
of empirical data, actually. And if there are any economists here, you're going to be deeply insulted, because my problem with neoclassical approach to economics is that it's like Euclidean geometry. You start with a limited set of axioms and develop a completely logical structure based on those axioms, and the fact that the axioms are wrong is just unfortunate. So you can't criticize a conclusion from neoclassical economics without criticizing the whole structure. And that leads to an inflexibility which I think makes neoclassical economics even harder to fit into a multidisciplinary enterprise than engineering is. Now, there are branches of economics that don't fall into that trap, ecological economics, for example. But that was the reason for that particular ground rule. And I'd seen too many environmental centres that had gone soft because they went all fuzzy. So my third ground rule was, if you want to have trees, that's fine, but that's not your job. Okay? Your job has to be rigorous. And if you're trying to set up an interdisciplinary centre like this, the rigour is very important, because people will be looking at you all the time to say you've gone flaky. So I'm all for hugging trees, but not during your working hours, right? And then we had a mission statement. We always had to have mission statements. And I'll come back to this one later, but I'll particularly highlight this one. Right from the start, consistent with this aspiration to make a difference in the world, we said we're going to present the results of these analyses in ways that will, of course, bring about change. And what went with this, and it's another thing I'm going to point out, was a very important feature of CES right from the start, was an industrially based engineering doctorate program. And we got some absolutely brilliant students on that. There's one of them on the panel later. And the big thing about that program was that the doctoral students were actually in the companies. They weren't at the university. They came to the university for courses, but they were embedded in the companies. And that meant that we had direct access to the problems which the companies were trying to solve, and they had direct access to the thinking that was going on in CES. So those practitioner doctorates, engineering doctorates, we call them in the first place, those practitioner doctorates were very much our missionaries. And I think that helped in a big way to give CES a problem-solving, practical slant. So what happened next? So we set up CES in 1992, which was, oh dear, yeah, what's going to happen? There we are. There we are. What also happened in 1992 was, of course, the Rio Conference. And it was the Rio Conference that really put the word sustainability, the phrase sustainable development, into the international lexicon. So I'll have to come back to what you mean by that, because it has to be defined. It's become a very debased, diluted word, and you have to be careful to define it. So I'm going to give you what I think is the appropriate interpretation. Okay, so 30 years ago, moving on 30 years, and we've moved beyond concern for environmental problems to articulating things in terms of sustainability. And so the university is setting up the Institute for Sustainability. So there, quickly, is a 30-year jump. What did this mean in personal terms? Well, it meant an intellectual journey. So personally, my journey in sustainability was a journey through different ways of thinking, different epistemologies, really. So it started with clean technology, also known at the time as pollution prevention. We went through environmental system analysis, and I better now pause and explain what that means, because it's an important part of what CES has been doing. The green thing on that diagram is what surrounds the economy. So if we're looking at ways to understand the interactions between human activities and the rest of the planet, we're doing what I call environmental system analysis. We're looking at the operation of the economic system. We're looking at what it brings in from the natural environment, what it releases to the environment in the way of emissions, and what it delivers for human society. So there's the model which underlies really the whole of environmental system analysis. And by the way, this is the original use of the word environment. You can nail it down very precisely. It appears in English in about 1820 in the translation of a book on thermodynamics written in French. And it's an anglicization of environnement, that which surrounds the system I'm interested in. So the sense in which I'm using the word environment here is the original sense. So environmental system analysis is about investigating how the economic system operates, how it delivers the service or function that we rely on it for, and what resources and emissions result from those economic activities. So that was the basis for a whole lot of work that we did, developing things like life cycle assessment, which is a way of looking at the environmental impacts of the whole supply system delivering, for example, heat to this building. Okay? A whole system approach. Right, but we go beyond that, and the current focus is on industrial ecology. And to explain what industrial ecology means, there is the quotation from Wikipedia. Now, normally, you don't use Wikipedia as a primary reference, right? Clear. But in this particular case, the definition of industrial ecology was written by a bunch of students on a master's program in the Netherlands as an assignment. So the definition of industrial ecology in Wikipedia is actually not bad. So here we are, complex integrated natural and human systems, so application of environmental system analysis, sustainability, that word which I'm going to have to get to in a moment, aspects of sociology, the environment, economy, and technology, explicitly. Well, of course, that attracted me because that's all the things I'm interested in, actually. You could have added classical music and string quartets and it would have been complete, but it's a pretty good start. Again, sustainable industrial systems keeps coming up, that sustainability word again. So the kind of intellectual processes, the kind of thinking that we went through this development from technological approaches through system assessment to really much larger systems involving people, not just technology, things, materials and energy. And that's where we've got to, and I'm going to come back and say more about that later. So that brings us up to date, 2022. University is setting up the Institute for Sustainability, and my pitch is that industrial ecology has to be an essential part of that activity. Right, sustainability. I've got to say more about it. Well-known diagram. The hands belong to the granddaughter of Miles, who's sitting in the second row here, I believe. The idea behind sustainability is handing the planet on in a decent condition to the next generation. Well, you've got to be a bit more precise than that. It's a nice picture, but what does it actually mean? So let me try and unpack that a bit. The concept really goes back to a report that was written for the United Nations, published in 1987, usually known as the Brundtland Report, because it was written by a commission chaired by Gro Harlem Brundtland, who was the Prime Minister of Norway. And it contains this famous phrase: sustainable development is about meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. is defining the idea of handing the planet on in a decent condition. So, in brief, what's the background? Well, the basic idea is that we're living beyond the capacity of the planet, and I hope that's obvious. Resources and emissions are exceeding what the planet can sustain in the long term. And furthermore, access to the scarce resources is not equitably distributed. It's not distributed equitably between the present inhabitants of the planet, and that's kind of obvious, and nor is it distributed equitably with future generations, because we're using up the resources, the carrying capacity, at a rate which can't go on for much longer. And of course, that's been the basis of things like the COP meeting that's been going on in Egypt this week. So there's the basic idea, but we need to get a bit more specific than that. And I found it useful over the years to represent the idea of sustainability in terms of this Venn diagram. It is original to me, but other people have thought it up as well. Okay? So you'll find it referenced in the literature. I know I thought of it because I remember the occasion. It was a transport cafe near Birmingham with Kate Birmingham and Rosalind Malcolm on the way to a CES retreat. And I remember drawing this, but other people have thought of it as well. It's not unique to me. What I'm basically saying here is that the long-term behavior of people on the planet is subject to three sets of constraints. The first one up here is the set of constraints imposed by the fact that we live on an isolated, finite planet. So that is represented, if anyone's into the field, the approach which I think represents it most clearly is the planetary boundaries approach, which has been developed largely by people in, well, around the world, but initiated in Stockholm. And the planetary boundaries people describe it as being defining a safe operating space for humanity. And that's the sense in which I'm using it here. So that ellipse represents the constraint, and the space within it is our possible operating space long term. That's just for environmental constraints. There's another set of constraints over here, which is represented by our ingenuity, techno-economic efficiency. And there are two parts to the efficiency lobe, and I think it's worth understanding the difference between them. One is scientific laws. You can't violate the laws of thermodynamics. Now, I have on occasions had to point out to people in the government that you can't buy indulgences against the laws of thermodynamics, and the market can't take care of the second law, sorry. So there are hard constraints there, but what we mean by economic efficiency is mutable. The aphorism, which I like, and it plays very well in China, is the laws of thermodynamics are carved in stone, but the laws of economics are written on paper. And we can change them. For example, we can change the tax system. And one of the interesting questions looking forward is what kind of changes to the tax system would actually nudge this lobe in the direction of better compliance with the environmental constraints. So that one is fixed by the planetary boundaries. This one is to an extent movable by changing the economic system, the fiscal system. Then over here, we've got the third set of objectives, and they're rather different because this is the requirement to provide equitable access to a decent quality of life to everybody on the planet now and in the future. So whereas that is determined by scientific laws, that's determined by science and economics, and that one is actually ethical. And you can't duck that one, I think. Inevitably, a large part of sustainability relies on normative decisions. It's ethical. Okay. So I'm not going to say too much more about that, because that will be another lecture or two in itself. If you recognize that there are these three sets of constraints, then sustainability, which is the possible long-term way of behaving on the planet, is represented by that bit in the middle where the three of them overlap. And if I'm optimistic, I think there is an overlap region there. If I was being pessimistic, I'd say there's no such overlap, in which case we might as well pack up. At the moment, we are not meeting those two sets of constraints. We're pretty good at techno-economic efficiency. We're lousy at compliance with the environment, and we're lousy at providing equity to the inhabitants of the planet. So sustainable development means starting from where we are and finding our way there. So there's my way of explaining what we mean by sustainable development. And in passing, there's an earlier document which is not as well known as the Brundtland Report on sustainability. It was written by a commission, chaired by Willy Brandt, the former Chancellor of Germany. Very interesting man. And Brandt's report contains this statement, and I wish it was as well known as the Brundtland statement, because he says very clearly, the prime objective of development is to lead to self-fulfillment and creative partnership in the use of a nation's productive forces and human potential. So Brandt is saying absolutely clearly and explicitly, and I think he's right, that when we say sustainable development, we don't mean economic expansion. Okay? We mean improvement in everybody's quality of life, and that is not by any means the same thing as economic expansion. So I am very firmly in the camp, well, I was going to say tofu-eating anti-growth coalition. Actually, I don't like tofu, but I'll admit to being a signed-up member of the anti-growth coalition. And that fits with other things that have been going on around CES. For example, some of you will probably know Tim Jackson's work called Prosperity Without Growth, very significant book. That kind of grew out of the thinking in CES. Tim first joined the university in CES and then set up a separate center. Again, that's very... I suspect it's Tim's book that Liz Truss was really sniping at when she was referring to the Anti-Growth Coalition. It's been that influential. So Tim, who wrote that book, said sustainability is the art of living well within ecological limits. Well, I've explained what I mean by limits. And living well in that definition doesn't just mean living comfortably. It means living well in an ethical sense, not at the expense of anybody else. And there's my version of it, a bit more pedestrian. It's a process of social development, not economic expansion, social development, subject to those techno-economic and ecological constraints. Finding our way to an equitable society, respecting the constraints on what we can do. Right, well, what else has happened in the big world since then? So roll forward from 1992, what's happened? In 30 years. 30 years ago, we weren't actually too sure about climate change. I was very skeptical about it. And I remained skeptical until working with Brian Hoskins, who happens to be sitting here, on a Royal Commission report called Energy, the Changing Climate. And Brian, you persuaded me that I was wrong and climate change was really a serious problem. So I think by now, you've really got to be perverse and self-deluding to think that climate change is not a real problem. There are people who delude themselves because it's uncomfortable, but it's, as Al Gore put it, an uncomfortable truth. Biodiversity loss become much more obvious. It's starting to find its way up the agenda, not far behind climate change as an impending problem. There are all sorts of things that go on to bring those together. For example, there's what's sometimes called the nexus. This is the problem of energy supply, water use, and food provision. So we really are looking at a world in which what 30 years ago appeared to be problems are rapidly becoming crises. And I don't think you can duck that one. What else has happened? Well, political stagnation. Look at what's been happening in Egypt over the last week. And public getting increasingly frustrated. Now, I think blocking the M25 is a stupid thing to do, however angry you are, because it doesn't get people on your side. But nevertheless, there is a lot of public concern, rightly so. And when I look at what's happening in the COP meetings, Sharm el-Sheikh this week, for example, it reminds me very much of an apartment building in Miami. Now, why do I say that? I don't know if you remember, about a year ago, a large apartment building in Miami collapsed and killed a lot of people. And when they unpicked it, what had happened? They had for decades been debating what maintenance needed to be done. They'd been debating who was going to pay for it and how they were going to do it. And while they were arguing, the building fell down and killed them. And the analogy between that and what's happening over the climate is a bit too uncomfortable, I'm afraid. So I refer to another great thinker, Kurt Vonnegut, underestimated, undervalued writer. And he said this, and I think he's got it spot on. We could save the planet, but we're too damn cheap and idle. So here we are, 2022, problems. We know about sustainability, but we haven't done very well in implementing the idea, solving the problems. So where does that leave us? Well, that gets me on to the second bit of the lecture. Not as long as the first half, it's always quite rich. Lots in the time. The role of academic activities in pursuing sustainable development. Given that we are at this really crisis point, where we know there are these crises, and we are finding it increasingly difficult to get the international political system particularly to do anything about it. Well, when I look back over the 30 years of CES, one of the things that strikes me is that probably the most influential things we've done have not been with governments. Now, I've been on various government advisory committees, national and international, others in CES have as well. And with the exception of one or two reports for the Royal Commission on Environmental Pollution, I think we've made much more impact in the work we've done with companies. So here's my take on what we need to concentrate on going forward. We've got to the point where there are these crises on the planet, so we're now looking at the need for system change, not incremental change. It's no longer good enough to do the kind of stuff I did 20, 25 years ago, asking whether this detergent powder is better than this one in environmental terms. It's now looking at the whole system that provides clean clothes. Okay? Not anything as specific as individual products. We're looking at system change, not incremental change. And so if I put this lot together, I'm looking to work with companies, not governments, because, frankly, we don't need any more research to tell us that climate change is disastrous. We know it. And we know in pretty broad terms what we can need to do about it. And by the way, the resources to change the global energy system are actually there, if only we could stop being so cheap about it. So I don't think we need diagnostic research. We know that we're in a mess. We've got to do something about it. The political system is stagnated. So what are we left with? We're left with companies. And that's a bit of a sometimes unpopular view, because a lot of the non-government organizations, for example, would like you to think that it's all the fault of big business. Actually, it isn't. Well, not entirely. I mean, I've got absolutely no sympathy, obviously, for the oil companies who turn up at Sharm el-Sheikh and lobby the process to say, it's okay to go on eating your grandchildren. No, it isn't. COP is about leaving carbon in the ground. stop pussyfooting about. And I think we're going to make more progress in getting over those crises by working with the economic system that we've got, rather than the fossilized international political system. Now, I could go into a side diatribe about the faults of capitalism, but I'm not going to do that because we've got the system that we've got, and these problems are more urgent than could be achieved by complete socioeconomic change. Right, so where does that get us looking forward? Well, I go back to the original mission statement for CES, and I focus on this one. Presenting the results of the analysis to enable informed technical, economic, social and political choices. But what I'm saying is, maybe going forward, it's more important to focus on commercial activities rather than international or national governments. And as I said, the doctoral program that we set up in CES was a very important tool for doing that. Before I enlarge on that, I better get something else out of the way. Whenever I give a talk like this, someone comes up afterwards and says, what about population? Well, here's what about population. Okay, if I look at it, for example, in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, the global emissions, E, are the global population times the per capita emission, by definition. Right? Over time, what changes? Well, the change in emissions, delta E, results in part from the change in per capita emissions and in part from the change in population. And if you work out those two terms using historical figures, you find they're pretty much the same size. Not equal, but comparable. And of the two, the term that results from growth in population is actually leveling off. Okay, population's got to something like 8 billion, and the rate of growth is tapering off. So the term to concentrate on is that one, which means what do each of us do? Lifestyles, consumption. It's the place to focus attention. Well, that's what CES always has done, because things like population demographics are way outside my expertise, so we never went there. So, coming back to the three, to the environmental system analysis, working with companies, working with finding system changes that will reduce the environmental consequences of delivering products and services, and looking at system change rather than incremental change. So the analysis now applies to looking at completely different economic systems rather than slightly different product routes. And let's not forget the three lobes of the diagram. Clean technology is system analysis and industrial ecology. We're actually all about this diagram. Clean technology focused on these two lobes, but the sociocentric, the equity lobe, is also very important. So how do we bring the equity issue into the system analysis? That's something where there hasn't been a huge amount of progress over recent years. So let me address that one. I'm going to stick with the framing of research approaches in terms of industrial ecology, which is the analysis of the flows of energy and materials through the economy, but I'm going to try to look at their social implications as well. So here's an example. Very, very macroscopic view of the way the economy functions. And I'm about to dismiss the idea of circular economy, by the way, although it's popular. So, since the Industrial Revolution, we've tended to operate with a linear economy. We make things, use them, and throw them away. And that's arguably one of the big things that's got us into the environmental problems that we've recognized. The circular economy people say we can do better than that because we can recover and recycle and reuse the stuff which we previously regarded as waste. And okay, that's a step in the right direction. You know, if you really do move stuff around a loop like that, you're reducing the amount of resources which you need to bring in to maintain the economic activity and provide for human consumption. But I don't think it goes far enough. And the thing which I think is missing is stock. Now, I better be a bit more concrete about that. Here we are in a room. The building is stock, it exists. The seat you're sitting in is stock, it exists. The heating is a flow. Okay, the heat comes in and leaks out. The basis of what I'm now saying is that the quality of our experience depends much more on the stock than the flow. For example, if the building is built to a good specification, the heat losses are low, and so the flows needed to maintain the building in a comfortable condition go down. So I think that the stock is the important part of the economy, which the circular economy agenda tends to miss out. Some versions of the circular economy recognize that, but not by any means all of them. And if you want to see the history of that, the European directives on the circular economy started out being only about recycling. The idea of maintaining the stock quality came in later. I mean, the current published definitions recognize the importance of stock. And that came about because a lot of people in the industrial ecology community lobbied the people in Brussels to say that if you just focus on recycling, you've missed the point. Okay? So there's quite a lot went on in the background there. This is also the way in which the equity lobe comes in, because stock doesn't just mean physical stock. It can also mean, and this is something I got from Sarah's colleague, Jonathan Porritt, the idea of five capitals. There are more than one form of stock or capital. There's manufactured capital, which is like this building. There's financial capital, which is your reserves in the bank, crudely. But there's also human capital and social capital. So social capital represents the social structures, practices that are built up, people related to each other. Human capital is roughly the skills of individual people. And the quality of life, I maintain, is much more dependent on these capitals than on the flow. And indeed, if you look in the literature, there's not a very good correlation in reasonably affluent societies, not very affluent actually, surprisingly. There's a reasonably good correlation between quality of stock and essentially no correlation between quality of life and disposable income. So your quality of life depends much more on the stock you live with than what you consume. And I could give you instances of that. Canada, for example, has a much higher quality of life than the US. Yeah, it really does. But the average income is lower, significantly. That's a direct example. Okay, so if the stock matters, what can we do about it? Well, the industrial ecology approach says, let's not look at the recycle flows. Let's start with the stock. So what do you need to maintain the quantity and quality of the stock which is in use, the building stock, vehicles on the road, and so on and so on? I won't go through the analysis, but if you do, what you find is that if you want to reduce resource use and emissions, and by the way, increase employment goes with it, all good things, the priorities are not what you thought they were. The most important thing is to maintain the life of the stock. After that, find ways to reduce the amount of stock you need. That leads to things like shared use. Increase the proportion of the stock which is remanufactured at the end of its life, and so on. which is not what engineers tend to do. Engineers start to think, well, we've got to improve the efficiency of the manufacturing processes. That's actually down the list. What's much more important are these top four. And as I said, the final version of the European directive on the subject recognised that, but quite a lot of effort went into getting it there. Right. I'm going to jump because I'm running out of time to that one. So if you follow through my logic, I'm saying we need to look at system change rather than incremental change. We need to look at the way in which services are provided. So we don't ask, how do we make cars? We ask, how do we provide mobility? That kind of thing. And following through the industrial ecology way of thinking, that says to me that we need to rethink the function of a service chain. So if, for example, you're buying a bar of chocolate, there you are, everyday example, all for eating chocolate, but you buy fair trade chocolate. And what you're doing there is buying chocolate from a supply chain which feeds benefits back to the beginning. Okay? You're not just buying stuff at arm's length. You're taking some responsibility for the producers back up the chain. Well, that's in the popular imagination as fair trade. But now I've dealt with a lot of companies over the 30 years of CES who recognize this and do it quietly. So they recognize that they have responsibilities to their suppliers. For example, there's a very well-known food supplier whom I can't name for commercial reasons, who put in a lot of work into improving the labor practices in the farms that provided their vegetables. Okay? So they were adopting this responsibility for people back up the supply chain. It's interesting that I can't tell you who the company are because they didn't want it publicized. Now you ask, why would a company that is really trying to do the right thing, why do they not want to publicize that? And the most common answer I've had when I ask that question is because the stock market doesn't like it. Because they'll think that we've taken our focus off profit. We're becoming too much of a social enterprise. Now, that also leads me to the next and final conclusion. The critical sector in all this is finance. Because if the companies are worried that the stock market is not going to like being told that they're trying to be good, how can you change the finance sector to overcome that and make sure the system does actually encourage and amplify the activities of companies who really are trying to be sustainable? So there's the conclusion of my thinking about working with commercial organizations for system change rather than incremental change. And it leads me to the conclusion that the key sector that we should have paid more attention to in the past is the finance sector. And I'm delighted to say that there's some work, which I didn't know about until today, going on in CES, which is trying to do exactly that. So I think the finance sector occupies a really important place in the kind of system change that we need if we're going to get over all these problems. So that was a bit of a gallop at the end, and I'll leave you with a shameless plug for my next and probably last book, which is due to be published next year, written by with George Martin and Rosalind and Simon, who's not here. What we're trying to do in that book is set out ideas on what a sustainable system might look like. We're not going to tell you how you get there, because that's something we're going to have to leave for future generations. But if we can leave something which says what the world might look like, at least that helps, I think. So look for that book next year. Thank you. I've been asked to take two or three questions now, and then hand it over to the panel. Questions? And there are roving mics, I think. Lady there in the striped.
Hello, Roland. This question about profit and finance and how neglected the financial approach has been, how do you address it when you've got water companies that think it's cheaper to put raw sewage into all our waterways rather than build desalination plants or purify the water?
Yes. Well, it's a good example. Obviously, that I see that as a fault of regulation, actually. The fact that the companies are allowed to be so cavalier means that the regulatory system has relinquished part of its responsibility. I mean, I didn't talk much about regulation here, but it's a very important part of the picture. But you've got to be very careful about regulation because it can also inhibit doing good. And, for example, one of the problems which the finance sector is facing is how to bring about this kind of system change, but be permitted by the regulatory bodies to do that. So regulation, I think, is working in a doubly perverse kind of way. It's not regulating against bad practice like the water companies, but it's regulating in a way which prevents constructive development. It needs a complete rethink. Gentleman in front of you.
Roland, not a question, but an observation. Thanks for a brilliant lecture, but you're giving it in the wrong place. You should be in Sharm el Sheikh.
Well, if I was invited, I would, Bill. Yeah. Yeah. And there was a lady in front there.
I know the ONS have just started looking at GDP and trying to rephrase it. Do you think that's going to help?
It would help if we could get GDP taken out of the picture as a prime indicator.
I was thinking of the financial components they want to look at, the happiness index.
I personally think that has got far too complicated. It's not carrying a clear message. I think the message has to be framed much more in terms of quality of life. And by the way, everybody quotes Bhutan as the model for that. I met, by chance, someone who'd been the British ambassador in Bhutan, and he said, don't you believe it, it's not like that at all. I'm sorry. But it means shifting the targets to quality of life. You know, things like the Sustainable Development Goals attempted to do and made a mess of, to my mind. But, you know, if you could fix things in terms of health metrics, longevity metrics, well-being metrics, and forget GDP, because consumption doesn't correlate with quality of life. It's the wrong metric. Rather than tinkering with it, forget it and find something else. Okay, I think I'll better leave it there. Time's getting on. Yeah.
As part of the proceedings, we now have a shortish follow-up debate with a distinguished panel here of eight people who've known Roland's work and known CES over many years. So if I could invite the panel to take a seat up here, you know who you are. There should be a slide going up, I think, that will introduce the panel. Roland, thank you very much. And we'd like to pick up on some of the points you raised here. We'll start off with a couple of questions that I will prompt the panel, but then we will also have an opportunity for the floor to raise points with the panel, as indeed the panel can raise points themselves. So in the interest of time, we're not going to introduce individual panel members, but I guess you can see all the names here and you can guess to who the name applies. If you get bored of the discussion.
There's a prize off.
There are no prizes. Very economic. Roland, thank you very much for putting up so many points in there. I think you made a key point, I think, about, and it's something we've come up in discussion as well, is you passed through system analysis and sort of, if you like, the traditional LCA type analysis and things like that. I got a sense that you were thinking that we need to move beyond that. I'm not quite so convinced. I rather like doing it. And I think it's important because it's still very possible to make poor decisions if you don't have the empirical evidence. And you spoke very strongly about empirical evidence. And so I'd like to put a point to the panel, because I thought that came through for me very strongly, is because the topic of the panel is the role of academic activities. It doesn't necessarily mean research, but academic activities in sustainable development. And so I'd like to perhaps raise the question first to Sarah, if that's okay, is that evidence piece, in order to be persuasive and to drive change, Sarah Sim, in this case, not Sarah Parker.
Oh, sorry.
But don't worry. Well, I can hear from you as well. Where do you see that fitting in how decisions could be made, perhaps following some of the lines of Roland's about resetting the system?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not fully convinced that we should abandon. I don't think you were saying that LCA completely.
I'm saying it's not enough.
But it's not enough, but I do think that there is a trajectory around a further development of tools such as LCA that allow us to look at more macro level analysis, portfolio analysis, systems and business model analysis, as well as deep dives into individual product development. So I think that what probably is required there is an evolution of LCA and equivalent approaches so that we get more potential for prospective analysis. And I don't mean consequential LCA.
No.
I mean prospective analysis, which allows us to produce scenarios into the future of what could be under different conditions. And they may be, in LCA terms, the foreground conditions, the things we're trying to change to make improvements in the system. But there may also be around some of those background changes. So under different scenarios, for example, the socio-economic pathways, for example, give a variety of different scenarios whereby the world might move in different ways, sustainability trajectories, roads divided, and so on. And those have a quite a coherent view around what could be different infrastructural shifts that occur as a result. And building those into background analysis, I think, is really very helpful in framing potential future scenarios and guiding the decisions in that frame.
Okay, thank you. Can I also perhaps pose a similar question to you, Gary, because you've had a lot of engagement with policy and ministerial advice.
Sure, okay. I'm Gary Cass, and I'm a visiting professor here in CES, so it's a great honour to be here. My day job is as a principal scientist within Natural England, which is the government's advisor on the natural environment. I've got a mic.
Oh, you've got one.
Okay, I'll try speaking up. Will you change the volume on the mic or something? Well, it is on. Well, the light's on anyway. So I'm Gary Cass, I'm visiting professor here in CES and a principal scientist at Natural England, which is one of the government's statutory advisors on the environment. We do the nice bits as opposed to the Environment Agency, which does the nasty bits. So we look after biodiversity and landscape and access and engagement and stuff like that. I've worked for 30 years at the science policy interface, and the role of evidence in policy making, decision making, is a very messy, complex, contested, and very frustrating place to be, but it's endlessly fascinating, which is why I spent 30 years doing it. And there simply is no direct or causative relationship between evidence and decision making. And, yeah. And basically, we knew this back in the 17th century, yeah. when John Hume set out the difference between ought and is.
Yeah.
Empirical evidence tells us what is, what has been, and potentially what might be with scenarios. And what policy does, it tells us what should be. And you cannot turn an is into an ought. So basically, evidence has to take its place within the wider panoply of all the other factors that policymakers and decision makers use in making their decisions. But that said, the amazing Canadian climate scientist Roger Pilker described in a wonderful book called The Honest Broker the different roles that scientists can play within the policy process. And he basically said there were four core roles, one of which isn't really a role in the policy process at all, and that's the pure scientist. And that's really what Roland set out to eschew at the beginning of CES. Mm. And their role is basically to create knowledge. And if you're lucky, they may even publish it. So it has no real role. And, you know, and if it has a role, it's accidental. People stumble across a paper or something, and if you're lucky, it may have some effect. However, there are then three other roles. The first of the kind of really effective roles then is what's called the science arbiter. And that's when a scientist is asked a very precise question to which they can give a very precise answer. And this is very, very rare. So don't expect to be a scientist and sit there and wait for the phone to ring and the Prime Minister to say, can you answer this question, please? What is X, you know, plus or minus three or whatever it is? So that's a really rare role. So you're then into the role of what's referred to as the issue advocate. And this is where having a scientific basis to your argument becomes absolutely key. And then you're in the business of making an argument. You're pitching for something you want to see happen. And sustainability science is inherently political in doing that because you were wanting to bring about system change. So you're inevitably, if you're setting out to do sustainability science, you are being an issue advocate. But do it openly. And what Roger Pilker says is there's nothing wrong with being an issue advocate, but don't be what he referred to as the stealth issue advocate, which is somebody who's trying to bring about something by pretending to be an objective scientist. And I think that's a really important distinction. The last role that he describes is what he refers to in the title of his book, The Honest Broker of Policy Alternatives. And that's where the scientist actually looks at what all the evidence is telling us about what's changing, what matters, to whom, and why, and actually then says, okay, well, this is the suite of alternatives and options, and then essentially brokers those into a process of options appraisal for decision makers then to make decisions on. So what I would argue then is that in response to Richard's question and the general title for this kind of talk, is that you're inherently in a political place trying to do sustainability science. But there are all sorts of different roles that sustainability science and scientists can occupy within that space. And the whole panoply of all those different scientific or academic activities, as Richard said, it's not just research, it's teaching, it's building the new generation of skills and capacities for our future to send people coming from this university out into the world underpinned with the competences and capacities to act in sustainability.
Thank you, Gary. And I can't resist the opportunity to ask Sarah Parkin to comment on that as well, because Sarah's had such a long career in advocacy for this.
I'm actually a bit uncertain about how to answer this, because I've got this feeling that we're talking as if we've got all the time in the world to get sorted. I do not have a sense of urgency, which I certainly feel. And Roland mentioned population. I'm chair of Population Matters, which is probably the only real advocacy population organization in this country. And it's, yes, you can say the curve's beginning to sort of level out. We've just hit on Tuesday 8 billion, but 9 billion and 10 billion are coming up fast. And they're coming up in countries like India and in Africa and parts of Asia. And we're fretting about a few immigrants here now. Just wait until all that movement starts, and it's going to start very soon. Now, that is not a technical issue. That's an ethical issue. And so I think we've got a bit of a problem here now. If we're thinking we can just sort of organically sort of kind of move forward, I would think universities have got a really big opportunity to put a big sense of urgency under absolutely everybody. We need to retrofit, not just passing politicians and businesses, but the whole population. And it was interesting, Roland, you missed out local government.
Mm.
You said, we don't need to worry about national and international government, and I would kind of think that's fairly correct. But local government, Jeremy Greenstock, who used to be our ambassador to the United Nations, he said, culture, politics, identity, everything is going local. And so it's really there that we need to start our focus. And it's already understood that it is localities that harbour terrorists. So the whole idea of preventing terrorism is to concentrate more in localities. But it's also where the emissions are coming from. It's where the misuse and waste of resources is coming from. So there is an opportunity to get a real urgency behind not just universities, but every part of the education system to do a really big retrofit of absolutely everybody so they all understand the really key things like the first law of thermodynamics, but we might need to rephrase it. But they have got the knowledge that they need in order to be able to live by generating an awful lot less waste. We also need to think, how do we do that for the countries that are currently poor and are currently going to be hammered by massive population growth? How do they, perhaps a third, perhaps a half of a billion women have no access to contraception. They might get it occasionally, but most of them have no access to modern contraception, so they have no choice about how many children they have. Now, that's a real big ethical issue, and we can do something about that, and it's an educational as much as a practical problem. So I would argue that one thing the universities could do, you've got so much knowledge, empirical knowledge, of how we are currently going to hell in a handcart. And I really worry if we are monitoring our own extinction as a species, because we've got more and more information about how everything's going wrong. And Roland's absolutely right about that whole shift, saying how do you solve the problems? But it has to be done extremely urgently. And so I would inject that, and I think universities got a big role to play in doing that for society, despite government.
No. Sarah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, you've struck a chord there, definitely. If I can be permitted one more, Roland, you made a very strong point about you see that the financial system and companies as being key elements of delivering the change that is going to be needed, and Sarah's referring to. So, Steve, you perhaps won't be surprised that I'd like you to offer a view on that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. It's just a pleasure to be here. Roland, huge congratulations. I look forward to your 11th. So I work for Aviva, an investment business, and I really strongly agree with the conclusion. We do need to desperately tackle finance. I'd just like to do a show of hands, very briefly. How many of you can tell me that you know what your pension's invested in, and you know how your votes at that company's AGM have been used to promote better practice? Right, okay, well, that's a few. That's wonderful. So some people are beginning to engage.
Yeah.
But the biggest problem of all is a lack of financial literacy in the demand base for the people whose money it is. It was the system was originally designed that the individuals knew what they owned. They would walk into a stock exchange, they would buy share certificates, they would sit in their safe, they would then behave as owners. That was the theory of moral sentiments to go alongside the wealth of nations. But it's so far removed from that now. The system has evolved so far as to disconnect almost all of you from your agency and your opportunity to affect corporate practice. But that's micro. That's not macro. That's not systems change. That's just thinking about how you behave as owners. I think Roland's absolutely right that we need to change the whole of finance, because at the moment, and none of you have mentioned it yet, the current lack of sustainability is so acute that at some point it will crumble the financial system.
Yeah.
And I speak for an insurance business and an investor. Mm-hmm. Now, climate change, obviously, the business as usual trajectory is nowhere near the Paris Agreement. I do come from, I was at Sharm last week. And people there are beginning to realize that the business as usual trajectory is 3.5 degrees by the end of the century. And that actually means mass migration of billions of people, which in turn can precipitate all sorts of national and international unrest. I don't need to continue to speculate further. Now, Bretton Woods, the system of finance, was originally designed to stop a Third World War, back towards the end of the Second World War. My contention now is that the current structure of finance is no longer fit for that purpose, right? So we need to now rethink banking, insurance, and investment regulation. We need to make sure there is a material cost of carbon, because until and unless there is, unfortunately, valuation won't drive capital in the right direction. And so while I absolutely agree with your analysis and your conclusions, Roland, up to a point, that point is that the political process needs to be engaged with still, because it is governments and policymakers and politicians that create that cost of carbon. You can't wish it into reality, even though I would love to be able to do that. And it is the G20, principally, that then will regulate banking, insurance, and investment and tell the finance ministers and the central bank governors that we need to rethink the system so that it does deliver sustainable growth, without which money stops working as a medium of exchange and a store of value and civilization is threatened. It's that big. It is that big. So we as finance individuals need to use the power of money and the agency it provides to engage with, that's why I was there at COP last week, to engage with the world's leaders and say, the current system is not structured to maintain price stability, to protect, but even GDP growth as it's currently defined won't carry on as it is. And we now need to repurpose and rethink the system using this kind of analysis. The problem, the biggest problem of all, and so just final point, I completely agree with Sarah, universities have an enormous role to play, because financial literacy, the point I started with, is missing. There is an enormous abyss. I haven't met anyone in the world who understands the whole of finance, and I certainly haven't met a politician that has a good grasp of it. That's the role of universities.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Steve. And to follow up on that same question, I'd love to hear a view from engineering members of the panel. If how do you view this, the changes that may be coming through?
Let me have a go. Laurel and Hardy, by the way. I'm not a social scientist, but don't you like the way this panel has composed itself around? Left brain, right brain, you can choose which is which. Okay. The one thing that Roland did not explicitly address was that different perspectives emanate from different understandings of timescales. Things that we need to do today, things that have impact over millennia. And I think the financial sector, and I'm not a financier, have got it all wrong. The stock market is driven by derivatives trading and things of that ilk, when in fact we should be looking for metrics that talk about more integrated behavior over longer time periods, and developing investment protocols and insurance protocols, etc., that reflect that commitment to a different time frame. And, you know, I'm an engineer, so I don't know whether or not that's doable in the short term, But it doesn't seem to me to be that particularly difficult to at least conceive of metrics such as that that might help us out of this morass that we're in. Because timescales mean different things to different people. I wear two academic hats here this evening, one of which is from South Africa. And the big driver for change around the sustainability agenda is something called the just transition. So how do you assist people to move out of an industry, typically fossil fuel, coal-based, into a different employment opportunity, a different lifestyle, in a way that is going to reflect positively on their material well-being in a short space of time, whereas the infrastructure that has underpinned their livelihood could persist for many, many years to come.
Yep.
So this issue of timing and time scales, I think, is really important.
Yeah.
Well, I'm the other Richard. There's a Richard there, and I'm the other one, and I'm at the top of this heap. Jim just mentioned the word metric, and I got into this sustainability business, I don't know, almost 30 years ago now, looking at metrics. I came from industry where I'd been working as an engineer, and I collided with sustainability, and what interested me was the idea of how does the work of an engineer change if he or she takes hold of the sustainability agenda? So how would my decisions change to make the world a more sustainable place? And that was a very concrete question. Because if you can't tell an engineer how his or her decisions should change, sustainability got no meaning. You've got to be able to put it into practice in your daily life. So therefore, I got into the idea of metrics and measuring sustainability, deciding, making decisions that would take you in a direction, deciding what sustainability is, looking at large systems and trying to decide why is one system more sustainable than another. Now, some years after that, I started to work with a colleague who's here, actually, Colin Axon, on energy security, because the energy economy is a big system, and you can think about the sustainability of the energy system, which, by the way, in this country at the moment is giving us something of a problem. And we got interested in the idea of risk. The difference between sustainability and risk and security, if you're looking at security, you're interested in where does the risk sit in the energy system, for example, or indeed any other system. And what struck us was that nearly all the work done on energy security takes an incredibly simplistic view of risk. It's kind of amateuristic and lacks empirical evidence, basically. So we were interested in putting empirical evidence into an analysis of risk. And linking up with what Steve was saying about bringing risk home to politicians about where the world is, kind of links in with that. Estimating risk is generally done, it's done by some industries. The insurance industry has a good understanding of risk. The betting industry has a good understanding of risk. The physical security, the military have a reasonable understanding of risk. The medical fraternity have a very good understanding of risk. They have to put into practice every day. But politicians seem to have a rather amateuristic view of risk. Linking that up with what academics should be doing, academics have a huge role to play in trying to put the tools together to help the right kind of choices, but I would suggest that risk is one of the things that we should be thinking much, much more about. Quite clearly, if we took a poll in this room, I think we would put the risk level relative to the environment at a rather high risk level. I think if we took the same number of people out of the general population, I think it would be somewhat lower, but still pretty scary. People who've been watching David Attenborough's recent programs about life in the, what's it called, the latest one about the frozen world, it pulled no punches about where we're going with the environment. The risk is visible to the population, but what can they do about it?
Yeah.
How do they put that risk transferred, translated into decisions that they're making in their everyday lives? That's not at all clear. Mm. So that's one of the roles for academics, to help sort that out.
Yeah. Yeah. Can I just add a little bit to that, because I agree so much with what you've said, and it's the one of the most dangerous things is to make people afraid of what is coming. And Richard Attenborough, who is, by the way, a patron of Population Matters, so he gets it really strongly.
David Attenborough.
He gets it very strongly. But I think one of the most dangerous things now, there are more and more people in this country as well as in other countries who are feeling really worried, really frightened, really pressurized, and we're not giving them agency to be able to do something for themselves. And that is a real dangerous situation.
Yeah.
And I think we're nearer to the sort of rebellions, you know, that we fear on the civil unrest than we think in many, many countries.
Mm. Thank you, Sarah. And I don't know if whether either of our Bento or Kate would like to pick up on anything. Did you detect anything like this in your own domains?
I think one of the things we need to be careful about, and I don't think it's what anyone is saying here, is assuming that we need to educate people to explain to them how to do things to kind of solve the problems that that are out there. Because I think actually public awareness and understanding is pretty high. Mm. And one of the issues is that often the kinds of changes that need to happen to move to a more sustainable future are not in the hands of individuals. It's not about, you know, changing the products you buy. And even if it is partly about some of those things, for example, many people don't have the financial resources or access to ways of changing some of those things. So I think, I mean, it's interesting because I've obviously worked with one for a long time, and we talk about things differently, but sometimes there's points of contact that are unexpected. And I think social scientists are thinking systemically as well, but they tend to think more about social practices. So we think about what people do, but we're not thinking about individuals as making individual choices and needing to change individual behaviour so much. Think about what are the ordinary, everyday, ingrained ways of doing things which are problematic, and how can we bring about what things need to change in order to bring about the kind of change in everyday life which delivers quality of life, but enables us to do things in more sustainable ways. And that involves changing cultural understandings as much as it involves changing technology and materials.
Thank you. Do you want to?
Yeah. Bente Pretlov. I came to Surrey more than 30 years ago, and I'd like to start by just thanking Roland. Roland taught me through the undergraduate studies. He coached me and supported me through my PhD, and he continues to inspire me, so thank you.
It was a pleasure, Ben. Yeah.
I thought I'd just say a little bit about how I've taken some of the sort of key learnings from CES and academia into commercial life, where I'm now. I work in a risk management and assurance company with more than 160 years of history, safeguarding life, property, and the environment. And what did I take with me? I think there are three key things that I took with me from CES. Multidisciplinarity, and the importance of doing that in all we do. Systems thinking and collaboration. And I thought I'd mention how we're now applying it, because it's taken me 25 years in this company to get to where we are now with these concepts. And system thinking has been up a lot. And what we're trying to do now is, you can think in systems thinking, can be within a sector. We work within the ocean sectors, maritime, offshore wind, you know, aquaculture. 70% of what we do is within that. But what we do now is, rather than looking at each sector separately, we're looking at them as a system. So we're looking at how do these sectors interact? Because if we're going to find the solutions to some of our greatest challenges, I think some of the barriers and some of the opportunities and solutions are in between, at the interface between these sectors. And then the second argument is also, it's not only between these sectors, but it's also how they interact with our environment. So those are some of the sort of key aspects that we've taken with us from what I've learned. Now it's been, it's come up also, I greatly kind of relate to one of the sort of key ambitions of CES that you put up on your list, and that is how to make information available for decision making. And me sitting on the other side, on the commercial side, this is something that I often struggle with. How do we actually interpret the science? How do we interpret the research and bring it into decision making? I used to manage the climate action program in my company. We actually had to employ our climate system modeler in order to be able to ask the right questions. So then there is obviously something, there's a gap here. And I think that will greatly help our commercial activity to understand what they need to do if that gap is filled. And I think that's a key role for academia.
I'd love to open the floor now for perhaps one or two questions to the panel. So if you could raise a clear hand, I'd be very happy to pick up on anything that anyone would like to pose. Yes, gentleman in the middle.
Thank you.
There's a microphone coming to you, but if you, if you've got a good yell, that would work as well.
Thank you very much for the discussion so far. I'd like to bring it actually quite locally, if I may, because the University of Surrey is placed in a town that is declared a climate emergency and in a county council that has declared a climate emergency. And so you've got a lot of academic knowledge, and you've thought perhaps about influencing international governments and at a wider scale, but the question is, how can you actually influence what is happening here in your real immediate locality, which is your home and where your many of your staff and your students live, but also could be a testbed? So the challenge back to you is, how could you help the local area get to net zero even quicker?
Thank you. I'm going to pass it to the panel. I because none of them are from around here. But I do have a view on that, and I will come back, and if time allows. We're pretty pinched for time, but would anyone like to offer a quick comment back to that that point about the what can we do as from the academic activities very locally here?
Well, I think that is an emphasis of the university, that we are a local university and we do work with local communities. And obviously the Living Lab projects have done exactly that kind of work and continue to be really important. And I think, I mean, in a way, one of the things that was missing in a way in Roland's talk, you can't talk about everything, but we talked about transdisciplinary research, which is talking about the value of academic knowledge. There's other kinds of knowledge that are really important, and that's the knowledge of local people, it's the knowledge of local communities, not-for-profits, various kinds of organisations and groups. And it's not just our job to research them, but it's to work with them, I think, and to bring those knowledges to the fore, because we need that knowledge to reach sustainable solutions. So it's not just about us with our lovely academic knowledge helping local people. I think it's really about working together a lot of the time and finding ways to do that.
Yeah, I completely agree, Kate. Thank you very much for saying that. And I would say one thing from myself in response to that as well, is that Roland raised the point about biodiversity is also very high on the agenda now. And I'm absolutely delighted that we, CES, are working with Surrey Wildlife Trust, and we won a major grant from the People's Postcode Lottery to work on biodiversity using high-resolution Earth observation for habitat networking creation in the county of Surrey. And also in about 10 days' time, the Surrey Hills Symposium, the fourth, I think, in the series, will be hosted here at the university. So we do a lot with working with the local community and indeed for the local community. So that's it. I would declare, I've got the Vice Chancellor's here, obviously, so tell me I'm wrong, but I would declare this university is really open to exactly that sort of thing. And I know that colleagues in other departments, politics, but us in CES as well, My colleague Ian Christie here was running a course just recently for Surrey County Council's library services about climate change. We do a lot of that sort of work, and we absolutely love doing it. So whilst we have an international perspective, and we're up there with international quality for our work, the local communities are absolutely vital. I'm sure colleagues from other universities will say.
I think there are actually quite a lot of examples around the country of universities working with local groups, introducing the right kind of agenda, and certainly Oxford is very active in that.
Yeah, and Jim gave us the example from South Africa as well.
Yeah, I mean, just to follow up on that, really, and it goes back to one of the platform positions that Roland started from, which was the 1992 UN summit. The Think Global, Act Local can be much broader than just considering local environmental issues. It's about the issue of inclusivity. Who gets brought into the conversation before you start framing a problem in ways that might suggest particular types of intervention? That mechanism of how people get brought into the conversation and how their voices are heard, I think, is fundamentally important, and it's clearly transdisciplinary. And if I was to argue for a current deficiency in technical stroke engineering curricula, is that they singly fail to understand their role as part of that conversation.
Yeah.
Someone mentioned earlier about, in fact, I think it was your point of different, no, sorry, it was Steve's point about different actors in the equation and different perspectives that flow from that. I think academics in general need to be a lot more humble in the way which they communicate their position, their disciplinary position, but in a way that is also encouraging of bringing in other voices to that conversation.
Marvellous. We can take one more. I think, Carol, would you like to?
My name's Carol Miller, and I run CRESS Business Awards, which is Surrey's only green business awards. And if it wasn't for the support of CES and the academic team here, we probably wouldn't have got the awards off the ground. And it's been great to have the support of Surrey County Council as part of their climate change work. And so I just thought I'd just make the shout out. We've attracted businesses from blue chip to very small SMEs, and it's great to see the work that they are doing to make a difference to the environment. So thank you, CES.
Thank you. There's a gentleman over there, I think, had a hand up first. I'm sorry, and I will have to make this the last one, so we'll ask for a pretty brief response from the panel, please, because the time is against us.
Yes, once again, thank you. My name is Avi Badia. I represent a company called SSE Energy Solutions, and hopefully in a very short space of time we'll be able to demonstrate some of the questions or answers to some of the questions about how companies and the university can help and improve sustainability for the local community. That being said, I'd like to thank the panel for a fantastic and interesting discussion. I'd like to raise a question to you, which, forgive me, is from a very layman's perspective that's born out of discussions I've had with my children, young teenage, well, adults now, both graduates from university, but an answer that we can't really get to. And I think Gary mentioned something about it, and Steve, as well as Jim, touched on this in different ways, as well as the risk issue. What does the panel think about if there was a way that we could change the world's attitude to short-termism, if you like, in terms of investment, if we could make it more profitable to benefit from longer-term investments, could that help us in the world of sustainability in terms of all of our problems seem to come from the desire to make a short-term profit, whether it's from day trading, whether it's from, from short-term returns to shareholders from our companies. If we could change that space to make it more profitable or more improve the incentive to a longer-term investment program, whether that's 5 years, 10 years, same with our politicians, would we not all benefit from that longer-term approach? forgive the simplicity of that question.
Well, I'm only an engineer, I have to say, and I'm very simple-minded and a positivist to boot. But for me, there's one very simple answer to that, and that is we've got to have a carbon price.
Got to have a storage
carbon price.
It's as simple as that, and it doesn't need to be very much.
Oh, it does.
Couldn't afford the price.
It doesn't need to be very much to start off with, in order to start the shift.
Can I, before we go to Steve, who clearly knows all this stuff in enormous detail, I'll just say that before I came along this evening, I was at on a Zoom call, which was the launch of a thing called the Deep Transitions Investment Philosophy, from a Deep Transitions Commission comprising 17, I think it was, of the world's big investment houses. Surprised that Aviva wasn't there, Steve. We can talk about this later. Include people like Bale Gifford and others. So there's like trillions in assets. And they've developed a suite of investment principles. Investment principle one, transform the system. That's what we've been talking about. Okay. Investment principle two, think long term. That's what we've been talking about. Investment principle number three, include and give voice, and so on and so on. Virtually everything that they have come up with, we have talked about today. So the big question then is, if the investment industry recognizes the need to move in this direction, and has set out a set of principles and an investment philosophy, how can it be made to happen?
Yes, okay. But I don't think you can, it's already been said, you can't change people's behavior by preaching at them.
And yeah, no, exactly.
It's extremely unlikely that you're going to change
what the commission has argued for is experimentation. But again, the sense of urgency that Sara has...
No, you have to put your elbow in the scale and make it much more expensive to emit carbon.
Okay, Steve, I would.
Wow,
Steve, can I?
How long have I got?
You've got about 30 seconds.
Right, okay. Thank you. So you're both right, and there's an enormous amount of other things that need to happen too. At the core of every fundamental valuation, every investor does a discount cash flow analysis. Yeah. That discounts the future formally. Yeah. It ignores externalities formally, and it assumes a terminal value, which might be 10 years, it's probably more an infinite growth of that company, a faded to the mean growth rate of about 2%. So they're assuming all things will continue to grow forever as the standard assumption. Those are the three founding assumptions of every DCF. No, DCF came from Chicago Business School,
so it's not baked in
neoclassical economics, but it is the way valuation is done.
Can't we regulate them to do it better then?
Because it's the way valuation is done, because it actually comes up with the present value. So how do you actually change that? I think we need to, so first of all, there's primary research that needs to be done in the academic community that needs to be better. Secondary, there's also, we need to challenge the efficient market hypothesis, because, I mean, goodness, there are no such things. Thirdly, there's a modern portfolio theory is now old enough to have grandchildren, and is no such thing, it is not modern. And there's so many changes to it that should be brought to bear. But the simple answer to your question is, yes, it is the problem. Short-termism is the problem. People haven't thought over the next century and realized where we're heading because of the likely three degrees plus change by the end of the century. We now need to bring a second Bretton Woods moment back into being. 80 years, next year, well, the year after next, will be the 80th anniversary of the Bretton Woods Agreement. We now need to bring the governments back and say, right, now let's recast the system that's fit for the next 80 years. That means banking, insurance, and investment regulation, and the cost of carbon that's way higher than it is. And by the way, I've heard everything from $75 to $30,000 a ton in the last week at Sharm.
Thank you.
Is that not the systemic change that we're looking for?
Yeah,
it is.
Penalize short-termism, encourage, incentivize long-term profit.
Yeah,
definitely. In fact, somebody at this...
I think you've just had a very straightforward answer, which is quite surprising, isn't it? Gary, I'm going to have to stop you. Sorry. I'd like us all now to thank the panel. The debate is getting completely out of control. everyone's losing the plot and coming up with immediate answers. Thank you very much to our panel.
Yes.
It's been very exciting. I'm sure the conversations will continue, as we draw this event to a close. So if we could show our appreciation to the panel and to yourselves. And with that, I'll invite the panel to take a perhaps a slightly more comfortable seat. And it's my great pleasure to be able to introduce Professor Lorenzo Fioramonti, who is the director, the new director of the new Institute for Sustainability that our president alluded to it in his welcome. So, Lorenzo, please come up, and the floor is yours to give us your vision for the new institute.
Good evening, everyone. I think there was a clicker here at some point. Roland, do you still have it?
No.
It's there. Sorry. Thank you. I suspect my slides would be there, but it's only one and a half, basically. So I really want to thank you for coming tonight. And your lecture, Roland, was extremely instructive. And the words, the concepts that you're going to see in my presentation will resonate a lot with what Roland has said. It's a bit disheartening that 30 years have passed and we're still using the same language, but there's certainly a strong alignment with the kind of agenda that the Institute for Sustainability will carry forward and what the CES has always been promoting here at the University of Surrey. We're about to launch on the 1st of December this Pan-University Institute, which is really going to take the lesson learned from 30 years of research on how to promote change through research to the next level, we hope. We believe that it's time for synthesis. As Roland said during his presentation, perhaps, and he said that 30 years ago, that there wasn't probably a lot of need for new research, but there was a lot of need for bringing together the different research streams. Well, if that was true in the 1990s, it's certainly true in 2022. We know a lot. But a lot of what we know is not brought together. It's not put together to offer workable solutions to the problems that we face. So with the Institute for Sustainability, we're going to focus on that. We're going to do a lot of synthesis across what is happening at this university and further afield to make sure that we can come together with solutions, with practical examples, with practices that are workable. We're going to build on a lot of the work that has already happened at this university across time, building links between the global north and the global south. Our logo is trying to represent that. The future of science, the future of action is about connecting the dots. Often scientists don't have enough time to actually look sideways. They're focusing on their own targets. They're focusing on their own objectives. But the solutions come from looking the other way around and looking at what your colleagues are doing. And colleagues are not just in academia. They're in business. They're in the nonprofit sector. They're in society at large. They're also in government. So our approach is going to build on what CSS has done so far and bring it, as I said, to the next level by creating a positive vision for change. You know, after listening to your conversation, to the presentation, to the panel, I get more and more convinced that one of the main problems we've been facing for so long is that the promotion of an environmental sustainability, of a sustainability at large, is often seen as a necessary sacrifice. And for as long as we see it as a sacrifice, we're not going to succeed. Mm. We need to make it look desirable. There is a beautiful cartoon from a few years ago at one of the COPs, you know, this image of COP 500, you know, and there's this guy standing up and says to this panel, "What if climate change is a hoax and we build a better world for nothing?" So that's precisely the point. We should do this even if there was no climate change. Even if there was no biodiversity loss, we can build a better society. That's what humans have always strived for, right? So that's what we need to achieve. And I think we do have all the knowledge necessary to be able to do that. But, and here I'm going to compliment Roland's lecture. In his presentation, he said his book is about giving you an idea of a future, of a desirable future, but it's not going to tell you how to get there. I think we want to do that. We want to try and find ways to get there. We want to have a theory of change. And again, connecting those dots is critical to what needs to happen. We need to build partnerships with businesses that want to make a difference. With the people within the businesses that want to make a difference, we need to find out who they are and bring them into the fold. And the same applies to governments. There are good people in governments. Often they're hiding. They're intimidated by the first-past-the-post electoral system. They may be intimidated by the rules of the game. They may be intimidated by the media, because the media also is reflecting on this issue, is projecting an image of change, which is often negative, seen as a sacrifice, seen often they even ridicule those that promote different ideas. So we need to bring all these champions and leaders together and make them, first of all, meet one another, know one another, and understand that perhaps through this building the demand for change, we can actually create those best practices that make a difference. There are governments out there that are trying to make a difference. Often they're isolated. And it's not just Bhutan. You know, Bhutan is a small example, not as perfect as many of us would want it to be. But there are many governments out there that are trying to make a difference. There are many localities that are trying to make a difference, but often don't know how to make that happen and do not want to lose elections by doing the right thing. They want to win elections by doing the right thing. So the Institute for Sustainability is going to bring together all the best practices we can find in science, in business, in policy, in society at large, bring those practices and start building those solutions and those ideas of change that will reinforce everyone's idea that this transition can be just, can be sustainable, and can be quick. I think, you know, as you said, I do feel the sense of urgency that a modern-day academic cannot just run seminars and publish papers. A modern-day academic has got a very tight timeline to try and condensate and amalgamate all the knowledge that is out there to provide workable solutions. And I think that's what the Institute is going to be trying to do. And the success of this Institute is going to rely upon the contributions of everyone, those within this university and those outside the university. We need those partnerships to be built. We need a lot of energy to make sure that the ideas that come from people in finance are going to be acted upon. What you said, Steve, is extremely right. For as long as we don't change the rules of the game, we're not going to get there. And we need to change the regulatory system. But to do so, we need to make sure that the policymakers will try to make a difference, meet the business leaders that want to make a difference, and meet the societal leaders that want to make a difference. Because if they operate in isolation, you know what happens? They get sidelined. They get overtaken by business as usual. And we cannot run against the rules and the incentives. We need to change the rules and the incentives. Thank you so much. And I think now I'll hand over to Richard again.
Thank you, Lorenzo. And I think that's a fantastic example of, you can see the ambition that's in the university and that builds on all the strengths that we've got in the university. You might have noticed quietly, just to my left, over there on the whiteboard, Veronica Keywood has been, evening Veronica, has been producing a graphic artist's account of this evening. And that will be finished off by Veronica in due course, and then we'll be putting it up onto the CES website alongside the recording of this lecture. So if you want to reprise things, you'll be very welcome to go to both those records. Thank you for your work, Veronica. This event simply could not have happened without you coming to it, for a start, but I'd like to recognize one individual in particular, and that is Caroline Stewart. Caroline, would you stand up, please?
Yep.
Caroline works with us in CES and in our practitioner doctorate program, and she's been the person responsible for putting together the overall package and framework for all of this, working very closely with Noel Ansel Epikela from our events team. So, Noel, thank you very much to you and your colleagues as well. President and Vice Chancellor, Roland, yourselves, thank you very much for your attendance. I'm sure you've enjoyed the evening. I absolutely feel it. It's been a pleasure seeing everyone, and safe journey home. We'll look forward to having a few chats as we finish, but this will end the evening's events here.
Thank you. Thank you, Richard.